Hi, good afternoon. Could I speak to David Sylvian, please?
Yes, speaking.
David, good afternoon. It's Jason Curtis speaking from South Africa. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great, thanks. I must admit this is a bit of a humbling experience for me. I've been a personal fan of yours for more years than I care to remember. But congratulations, first of all, on Dead Bees on a Cake.
Thank you.
How does it feel to be back?
In what sense?
Well, without getting into the obvious, you've obviously spent a bit of time away, obviously concentrating on things closer to home, and now you're back with an album with your name on it. How does that feel?
Very satisfying, actually, because I've been involved in collaborative work for such a long time. Although I've gained a lot from the experience of working in that context, often I've found that the work was less than 100% as far as I was concerned, because there are many compromises made along the way. Mm-hmm. In the process of collaborating. Mm-hmm. So there are many rewards to creating the work. One often feels that you can't stand by the work 100%, whereas mm-hmm. with my own solo work, I feel a lot more comfortable with it. And this being an album with a greater continuity than many of my other solo efforts, mm-hmm. I feel I can stand by it. I feel that it does document a period in my life very well.
Mm. Was it a bit daunting, as I say, after having done all of those collaborations?
Initially, no, it wasn't. It was a relief to get back to both songwriting and the solo work.
Right.
So there was a great deal of excitement attached to starting the project.
Mm. Mm. Would you say that you've been fortunate in the sense that you've had, say, perhaps the luxury of being able to follow, you know, your own heart and your own vision, really, to the point that you've been able to do the kind of release the kind of albums you have, obviously, and take the time that you have in putting, say, just for example, the new album. That you haven't been rushed in typical record company style.
There is a luxury in that, and that luxury really comes from recording most of the material at home and not working in studios, because the budgets for the album that I record are never really that big. So it's a matter of creating that space for myself, which I was fortunate enough to do with this particular project. In the past, there have been time constraints on most of the projects that I've been involved in. So it was a quite liberating experience on many levels.
Mm-hmm.
And also being my own producer on this project was an experience that I learned a great deal from.
Mm-hmm.
And again, it liberated me from the need to depend on a second opinion on everything that I was doing.
Mm-hmm. But when you look at the album as a whole, which element would you say of it was the most important that had to work in order for the album to work as a whole?
The writing.
Mm. Mm.
I would leave I started recording the album. When was it? It was such a long time ago. I didn't keep track of it. But I would leave for the album for months at a time. I would move away from it, not listen to it, and then return to it. And because the material was strong, it enabled me to keep returning to it over and over again.
Mm.
with a sense of excitement and enthusiasm.
Mm.
Had the material not been strong enough, it would have been passed along the way. You know, it would have stopped. Mm. One or two pieces didn't make it.
Mm-hmm.
They just weren't quite strong enough. But on the whole, the material I thought was very strong, and that's what kept me going, kept me working at this album, trying to get it completed.
Mm-hmm. Now, as I say, I mean, the album as a whole, so I was actually just going through the EPK earlier today, which as I say in itself is a work of art as well. But in putting the album together and obviously putting the tracks together as well, and selecting which order you would feature them on the album, was that important that they appeared in the order that we now have them on the finished album, that they told the story the way it needed to be told?
Well, yes, it's always important. The sequencing process is important. It wasn't a difficult process with this album. Mm. I'd been working on it for so long. It was a bit difficult for me to be objective about it. Mm. But I felt the album should open with Surrender, because it really laid the foundation for, in terms of like, thematically for the rest of the album.
Mm.
And I just tried to pace it in such a way that the listener wouldn't necessarily know what kind of album they're listening to until they've reached the end of it.
Mm.
Because there's a diversity of material to be found on the album.
Was it difficult, as I say, with the amount of time that you had in putting it together, to actually keep a focus on keeping it as a unit or as an album, and keeping all of the elements, linked together?
No, because they're born out of a particular period in my life. I felt that there was a unity there initially, there are many different influences throughout the album, but I never felt that they were in conflict with one another. There were a couple of pieces, again, I didn't allow to be put on the album, just because there was something in their nature that didn't sit comfortably with the rest of the material.
Mm.
But that was, generally not the case. Generally everything seemed to hold together.
Mm.
Because I think that it was born out of, the themes running throughout the album that are important to me are love, devotion, and divine intoxication. And that runs throughout all the material on the album. There is no exception.
Because, these are obviously universal themes, but, you've encapsulated them, and to say, again, just going back to that EPK, you don't refer to an I, you refer to we, which is obviously your family. And that obviously has had a profound effect on this album and its creation.
Oh, for sure. Mm. Yeah. All the events surrounding my life during the period of writing and recording the album are in some ways represented in the work.
Mm.
And it was one of the most eventful and enriching periods of my life, so that's got to shine through in some way.
Mm.
And so the family is very important, obviously, and also the teachers that I've encountered along the way during that period have been very important to me, and some of their teachings do in some way shine through in the work. Maybe not in a very dogmatic way, but in a very subtle way in the writing.
Mm. And it's, as I say, obviously when you relocated to America, when you look back at all the events that came before putting this album together, obviously it was, was there a point that you had thought to yourself, oh my God, what have I done? Maybe I've taken the wrong, the wrong route, that you perhaps doubted, where you were going, and basically your whole life moved, because over the last couple of years, it's been, there's a lot that's happened to you in a relatively short period of time. Were you always sure that you were on the right path?
One way or the other, yes. Even when we made mistakes, and we did make mistakes, we felt that they were the right mistakes to make, if you want to put it that way. They suited our need. And we had to learn from them to be able to benefit from them and move on. And we did benefit from them enormously. So anyway, you have life experiences of different kinds. Some are obviously uplifting from the moment you start to experience them, and others can be quite devastating in some ways. Mm. But nevertheless, if you can keep hold of the fact that the view that this is the right move for you, the right lessons at the right time, enables you to keep moving on and not get obsessive about what is actually you're in the process of experiencing.
Mm, mm, mm. And again, sort of documenting all of this, you know, in lyric and music. Are you the kind of writer that is aware of an audience that needs to interpret this, or is it a self-indulgence in the sense that you will create what you create, and whether people and your audience get it in their own way, you know, almost say not spoon feeding them at all, but creating this art and saying, well, I'm putting it out in a way that it makes sense to me, and this is my story now. How, you know, is it important that your audience gets it and is able to interpret it in the same way that you wrote it?
The act is one of communication. Mm. There's absolutely no point in doing this, creating this work, if you're not trying to communicate something. Mm. That would be an act of indulgence.
Mm.
And maybe cathartic for me, but not for anybody else.
Mm.
So the work has to be open to be applicable to any person's life. It's not about reading about David Sylvian's exploits over the past so many years.
Mm.
It's how can this work function in a multitude of lives, you know, enrich their lives, the lives of the listeners.
Mm.
So although I don't have a specific audience in mind, I'm fashioning the work in such a way that it reflects the concerns and the emotions that are important, and therefore has a function.
Mm.
Just in the same way that somebody might fashion or design a cup or a glass for use in the world. You know, you may not have a specific person in mind, but you know its function.
Mm.
And no matter all the aesthetic concerns that go into making that cup, ultimately somebody has to use it.
Mm.
Well, there's more to it, to a work of art than maybe, you know, fashioning a chair or a cup. That's craftsmanship. But there's something comparable there, in that when a piece is finished, you know it embodies something tangible, and you know that somebody is capable of pulling out from that piece of music something powerful for themselves.
Mm.
But you know, it depends on the individual and how they approach the work, whether they find it or not.
Mm. And I mean, I think in the process as well, I think you filter out a lot of people who say are perhaps well, to the point that the audience that remains after having, say, consumed your album, that they are still there. Those are the people that you would want to have as your fans, and as the people who appreciate your art, than say that those who don't.
Well, I can't really be the judge of that.
Mm.
You know,
mm.
Somebody that listens to the album and rejects it now may not reject it in 5 years' time.
Mm.
You know, I've been guilty of that, rejecting a work of art on my first contact with it and coming to absolutely adore it later on in life and finding it very, very important work for me.
Mm.
So that there's really no knowing.
Mm.
It's not, you know, it's not something for me to anticipate and to judge beforehand.
Mm. Because, I mean, musically, the one thing that's always enchanted me about the music that you've created over the years is that there's never been anything musically that has tied you to a period or to a style. I mean, I think even, you know, if you go back as far as your days in Japan, that it was almost by, you know, when pop culture changed and started embracing what you were doing there, it wasn't something that I don't think you had done, you know, with intent. It was just that all of a sudden it actually made sense to a wider audience because of what was happening around it. But your music has always it's always, I think, stood apart from anything else that's been going on. And it actually interests me how you actually get, you know, if you get that purely by, you know, the manner in which you create it, or are you actually aware of what you're creating and how you're creating it in order that it stays almost timeless?
Well, maybe, I'm not sure I agree entirely with your view that Japan's music sits out of time. Not that we, as you say, were trying to attempt to belong to any particular group in time, at that point in time, that the events did kind of catch up with us. But there was a greater pop mentality at work there that was aiming for a particular kind of market or success, if you like, although at the same time remaining true to ourselves and our own needs. I think as time goes on, I've just become more immersed in my own life and less conscious of the commercial requirements of my work. And as such, it documents a period of growth, both as an artist and as a person. I think, you know, I do take in a lot of information. I listen to a lot of music. I'm not always aware of the context in which that music is being created, because I don't get my information from TV or radio or newspapers. I just walk into a store and pick a random music to listen to. So it's possible to have contemporary influences in the work that I create, but it's not attached to. It's not. I don't see it within a particular context. You know, understand what I mean?
Yes, I do.
So I guess that it's. I'm writing from a very solitary standpoint. It's something that I'm writing material that is documenting a life experience in the best way that I can. And for all the other references that can be made in my work, there is a voice of, there is an experience there that can't be denied, that can't be taken away from the context in which it is heard. And therefore, even if some of my work was appropriated now and put into a bag of an event that was happening in the 1999's contemporary state of music, it will always sit slightly outside of that, in the same way that other people that I admire sit outside, and that there is a truth to the work that goes beyond the context in which it's heard. People like Robert Wyatt, for example, is a good example. Other people from the past, like Nick Drake, there is a truth and honesty gained through life experience that is represented in the work. And no matter how that person's work is defined in terms of like a context of musical influences and all the rest of it, there is a truth that rides above all of that, that can be renewed. You can go back to it over and over again, because it's the essence of the work. It lies beneath all of the external and superficial influences that are the trappings of the work.
Yes, because I mean, I think, again, you know, as you say, it's your work is very, you know, for lack of a better description, three dimensional, in the fact that it's not one dimensional commercial music. There are, as you say, all of those elements encompassing it, which gives it its almost ongoing fascination to your audience. And I think, you know, that's, and Ren welcomes that revisiting, which I think is so nice. But as far as the album now being released in March, do you have any sort of expectation of it? You know, that it's of it doing anything over and above the obvious, but obviously you're putting it out there. Do you have any expectation?
Well, you know, as I said, it's about communication, and I think most people that create work want to communicate with as large a number of people as possible. They hope that the work will resonate, you know, with many people, that many people get to hear the work. I don't know if that's going to be the case. It hasn't been the case in the past, you know. So I live in hope that their larger audience is out there, that they can, that the work will reach them in some way or another, through one means or another. But I just wait and see. I don't tend to pin hopes or expectations on the work.
But would you describe the time now for you, especially as I say, coming up to the album's release, as an exciting time for you?
It's always an exciting time when an album is being prepared for release. Yeah, because you know it's going to find an audience of some kind.
Mm.
Because it's particularly if you're close to the work and you believe in the work, you care about it going out into the world.
Yeah.
And so there's all the elements that go along with its release. I take personal care of every aspect of it. So it is exciting to put it out into the world in the right manner. And you know, just looking forward to people receiving it and gaining something from the experience. It's great. It's a wonderful time.
Wonderful. Well, David, thank you so much. I think I've used up my time with you, but as we say, congratulations again, and a sterling album, I think, and congratulations not only on your music, but on a life that seems to, dare I say it, it's almost fairy tale like, and I think a fantastic achievement on all levels.
Well, thank you. That's very kind of you.
It's a pleasure, and thank you again.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.